Hey friends, welcome back to FTD Speaks. I'm Sarah Carvalho, and today we're going to be watching a video about what it's really like to be a Muslim woman in America. So let's get to it.
You know when people are like, do Muslim women like have hair under?
I'm like, no.
You don't.
Plot twist, go look at them, our secret.
There's actually no hair.
Oh my God.
Do they have hair?
I don't know how I'm gonna start this. I just wanted to come on here and speak because I felt like I had to. Let me just address, yes, my head is covered. I am Muslim if you guys didn't know that, but my channel is for everyone. We're in for a ride. And we just have to stay strong. Bye guys. I feel like people just like refuse to believe that I'm a normal girl. I started wearing the hijab almost 2 years ago, and I was going through a lot. I was really confused at the time, and I really turned to my religion. Before I started wearing the hijab, I was actually a natural hair blogger. Even prior to wearing the hijab, I was always a bit hesitant because I knew a lot of my followers weren't Muslim. And now I'm like, it's like a part of me, so why would I hide that? Today, I just want to share how I maneuver as a Black Muslim woman in Los Angeles. I'm going to meet with my good friend, Neelam, and we're going to chat about our shared experiences being Muslim women, and we're going to do it over a manicure. These ones are halal. Halal means that it's breathable and it's vegan. I'm going to do white.
Okay.
Cheers. Let's go before I change my mind.
Cheers.
Cheers.
How are you loving LA?
I am obsessed with LA. I feel like I turn into a Cali girl so fast. I mean, it's obviously different from Minnesota. Like, I came here and it was such a culture shock.
Speaking of Minnesota, like, I was just there.
You were just there, yeah.
And one of the number one things that was shocking to me is to go any place and see a hijabi, a group of hijabis.
Yep.
And I was just like, whoa. Like, coming from LA, you don't see that. Mm-hmm. So I understand the culture shock. Like,
yes. I don't know if I ever told you this story, but I was sitting at Earth Cafe with a couple of my friends, and it was like we were caged animals. It was the wildest thing ever. Like,
oh,
we were just sitting,
staring.
You know, enjoying my avocado toast like always, and like this girl is staring at me from one side, and then I see this other girl staring. I see firefighters in uniform just completely staring at us.
You know, I just recently started wearing the hijab just only, what, like a year ago? Like the transition to like, okay, I'm going into modest fashion and wearing my hijab. You know, I feel like it's been positive. LA is like a melting pot of people from everywhere. I feel like they're really open out here. So it's not like I haven't really gotten any like backlash, but I have, you know,
seen
the
hate.
Stares. It's not hate. There's no hate. I don't, thank God, I haven't experienced that like pure Islamophobia and just like pure hatred or anything like that. Nothing like that.
I remember being in this restaurant and this guy like brought me my food and he was like bismillah, and then after he's like alhamdulillah, and I was just like, that's cute that you like just you know,
sweet.
Like went out of your way to just like
I love
it's nice that you like went out of your way to be like, hey, like I see you and I respect you and I appreciate it, and it was the sweetest thing ever.
Now that I have my henna manicure, I thought it could be fun to chat about the art of henna. Nadia is a makeup and henna artist. We're going to chat about Muslim women as well as get my henna done.
I love henna so much. I've always really, really loved it. And I've always been so proud of it.
Alright.
So do you like examine people's hands?
I do.
You start?
I have to figure out what's the best way to make your hand look attractive. So I think with your hand, we're gonna concentrate on the majority of the design, traveling from this end down your index finger and like basically covering this part and giving you some like drapes down here.
So right now we're doing black henna because I know for me it's culturally what Sudanese people do.
Mm-hmm. The color of this henna is black because it's mixed with jagua. Jagua on its own will color, like the stain looks like a tattoo. For a lot of Indians and Pakistanis, there is a thing that a bride has to hide her groom's name in her henna. Back in the day, brides didn't know their grooms And so, like, here you're married to a stranger and it's your wedding night. So as an icebreaker, he has to find his name in your henna. But what brides are doing nowadays is they're not hiding the name. They're making it like very prominent. Henna has cooling agents in it. In Africa, henna is not used as much for decoration purposes. You know, women tend to do it on their bellies too when they're pregnant because it helps cool their bodies.
I love
that. I think I'm done.
Yeah. I love it. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
I really appreciate it.
It felt really wonderful to get my henna done, and I love the design, but now it's time to talk about something really dear to my heart, the hijab.
I think a lot of the stigma surrounding the hijab stems from a lack of understanding about Islam. I'm headed over to see my friend Maria, who runs a hijab company. It's so cool to me how there's so many different ways to wear the hijab. And how does your family typically wear it?
Well, what's interesting is because, you know, my mom is Mexican.
Yeah.
And she's a convert to Islam, born and raised in America. Mm-hmm. So she never had like a culture that practices the concept of hijab. She would wear like the one pieces. And so when I became ready to wear the hijab, I could not relate to that. So what my mom told me to do, she inspired me. She said, let's go to Joann's, get fabric, and sew your own scarves.
It's hard when people only talk about the negative aspects of it because of course that comes with it inevitably, but like they focus so much on that.
So when you think about like the future, do you get nervous at all? Or
I'm nervous, but I'm more optimistic and more excited than anything.
That my fear, I'll be honest with you, stems from the fact that I'm, you know, Mexican Arab Muslim. No. I was in liberal Santa Monica, sitting outside of a very well-known cafe reading a book. And a guy comes over, passes by me, and just stops in his place and goes, how could you let her sit here? Does anybody see this? Nobody go over there. Don't you see that there's a dumb Arab bitch? I literally said a prayer. And he threw the table that I was on towards me. Thankfully, it didn't hit me. But I'll be honest with you, like, aside from that being really scary, and he like kind of ran off after that, the scarier thing was that there were two elderly white women who were sitting next to me, and they didn't say anything. You know, but it was things like that that made me realize, like, this is 2018. I'm an educated, you know, self-sufficient woman. You know, I happen to be of mixed background and outwardly Muslim, but like, why is this happening? You know what I'm saying? It should never happen. So that's where I say, like, I do have a bit of fear. And the fear kind of gets channeled into like an engine running for me to like make sure that the future is better for my children.
I'm a first generation American. So for me, it's really important that my kids are able to take the best of their Sudanese culture and the best of their American culture, and obviously have Islam, and they are able to shape their narrative and what it really truly means to be American Muslim. A lot of the Muslim women that we see in social media have to do with beauty and fashion, and I think that's great, that's a step. But there's also Muslim women who are doing other things that are so incredible that aren't getting the recognition. So when I think about the future, I want them to get the recognition as well, you know? And I think right now we're shaping it. There's so much representation, but I'm just so excited. There's so much stigma and negativity surrounded around how people perceive the hijab because that's what's in the media. And you can't necessarily blame people for what they've been fed, but you can blame people for not wanting to understand.
It's really sad to know that people might judge me because of my religion, and I think that comes from a lack of knowledge and a lack of empathy. But at the end of the day, I'm really proud of my religion and I'm not afraid to show it. I am truly hopeful that if we make the effort to share our stories, we can break stereotypes and focus on living in a world where we can all belong.
Okay, so I have to say that at the beginning of the video, when they were getting their nails done, I was a little bit concerned about what this video was really going to be about. It really just seemed like two girls getting their nails done, just talking about how great it is to live in Minnesota and also some of their experiences. Wasn't really getting to the heart of the title of the video, of what is it like to be a Muslim woman living in America. I think that as the video progressed and she talked to several different people, we were able to see a different narrative kind of coming to light, a reality, an experience of what some women might experience on a day-to-day basis. And I love that in the beginning, you know, that one, the first girl, when they were getting their nails done, she comments and says, you know, thank God I haven't had any horrible or frightening experiences here so far about in reaction to me being a Muslim woman wearing a hijab. But the host of the video, she seems to have quite a few uncomfortable experiences, and as well as her friend who has her own company creating different headscarves and hijab. So I think that you can see through this video that it would be unfair to categorize all Muslim American women in the same way. I think it really depends on which state you live in. What are the cultural expectations? Is the state more open-minded? And that's the, kind of the unfortunate part, is that depending on which state you live in, you might find different treatment. And I think that is the main issue that this video is trying to expose, is that these are women who are just trying to practice their faith. They are just trying to live in modesty, still be fashionable and still look beautiful. They are absolutely beautiful and still show their own individualism. But I think it's really unfortunate to see, like, that example, that story that the girl told us, where she was at a restaurant reading a book and some stranger who knows nothing about her, nothing about her history, nothing about who she is, decides to stop and spread hate. And then you have these two bystanders who say nothing. And I think that's the most important thing we need to talk about, is the fact that people are willingly uneducating themselves. People are happy to live in their own ignorance. And when I say ignorance, I don't mean stupidity. I mean, you're refusing to look at a different perspective. You're refusing to look past what you have been taught or what your mainstream society has exposed you to. And you have an unwillingness to be open-minded, an unwillingness to seek information, to seek understanding. I think that if you stop and you actually speak to a hijabi, you would leave that conversation quite enlightened. And really, this is the way that we solve these problems, these biases, these preconceived notions that we have, is by stopping and asking those questions. I feel like if you were to honestly approach a hijabi and say, look, this is what I've grown up believing. This is what I've been taught. This is what my society and culture has taught me to believe or to think. And I'd like to know more. I'd like to know more from your perspective, from your experience. Why do you wear the hijab? What does it mean to you? You know, how does it influence who you are as a person? What does it add to or maybe take away from who you are? And just sit. I guarantee you, no one is going to turn you away and no one is going to be angry with you or be offended. In fact, on the contrary, I believe they would be more than happy to sit and have that educated, open-minded conversation. I think that if anything, this video could have gone a little bit more in depth about really the day-to-day experiences that different women have, you know, and what it means to be Muslim in America, living a day-to-day life. But I do like that it did bring up these very important issues, which we have kind of discussed in today's video. So my friends, let me know what you think. What was your feelings on this video? Hopefully you were with us through the whole thing. I know at the beginning it seemed like it wasn't really going to pick up, but it did. And I think it had some great lessons and speaking pieces for our video today. So how do you feel? Are you a Muslim American woman living in America right now? Could be Canada or the United States. We can include all of North America. But what is your experience here as a hijabi, or as someone maybe related to someone who wears the hijab? You may be Muslim and choose not to wear hijab. So what has been your experience with this living wherever it is that you live? Do you find that there are people that are understanding? Do you find there is a lot of judgment? Do you find that there is a lot of curiosity? Do you find that even in your attempts to be modest, that you are still getting stared at and put in uncomfortable situations? So let us know. We love to hear from you, and keep an eye out for future videos. Don't forget to like and subscribe, and absolutely you must check out some of our recommended videos in the description section. We'll see you right here next time on FTD Speaks. Bye.